Good morning. Up to this point, we have only considered stationary fluids. Today, the fluids start moving.
Flipping physics.
Now, just like when we first learn about projectile motion, we do not include air resistance. When we first learn about fluid flow, we begin with ideal fluid flow. In reality, the motions of fluids can be extremely complicated. However, beginning with ideal fluid flow helps us start to understand how fluids flow. The four conditions for ideal fluid flow are: the fluid is non-viscous, the fluid is incompressible, the flow is steady, and the flow is irrotational.
I don't think I even got all that written down yet.
Okay. Relax. I was just getting all four conditions of ideal fluid flow out there so we could now discuss them in detail. First, in ideal fluid flow, the fluid is non-viscous. Viscosity is the measure of a fluid's resistance to flow or a measure of the internal friction in a fluid. For example, water has a low viscosity, maple syrup has a viscosity which is higher than the viscosity of water, and the viscosity of ketchup is higher than the viscosity of maple syrup.
What are the units for viscosity?
How do you measure viscosity?
What is the viscosity of blood?
Yeah.
Right. We are really not going to discuss viscosity much. The whole point here is that ideal fluid flow involves fluids that are non-viscous. Fluids that have no viscosity. Viscosity of a fluid causes kinetic energy of the fluid to be converted to internal energy. Therefore, when we say an ideal fluid is non-viscous, we mean it has zero internal friction. None of the kinetic energy of an ideal fluid is converted to internal energy.
So there are no fluids which are truly non-viscous?
Right, but it is a good place to start and really helps with understanding how fluids flow.
All objects in projectile motion on planet Earth actually experience air resistance, and yet we still do a lot of calculations pretending they do not, so...
Okay, sure.
Next, an ideal fluid is incompressible. That means the density of an ideal fluid remains constant. Liquids usually tend to be rather incompressible. However, gases really are quite compressible. And then we have the condition that ideal flow is steady, or what is called laminar flow. Flow that is non-steady is called turbulent flow. Turbulent flow is irregular and inconsistent. Typically, slower speeds are necessary for laminar flow, and faster speeds cause turbulent flow. A common example which shows both laminar flow and turbulent flow is the smoke which rises from a recently extinguished candle flame. The smoke which is right above the candle wick shows laminar flow. You can see it is smooth and steady flow. And the smoke above that is showing turbulent, irregular, and inconsistent flow. Turbulent flow is also often rotational as well. As the smoke rises, the speed of the smoke increases. Where the smoke is lower and moving more slowly, it is laminar flow. Near the top, where the smoke is moving more quickly, it is turbulent flow. Another fun example which shows laminar and turbulent flows is the flow of water in a river. This is the Upper Yokogane River, where I went whitewater rafting last summer with my wife and two friends. In addition to hearing my exuberant excitement,
yeah,
you can see the mostly laminar flow of the water at the top of the waterfall, and the entirely turbulent flow of the water at the bottom of the waterfall.
That looks like fun.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it really was. Now let's look at a highly simplified animation I made showing ideal fluid particles with laminar flow going through a cylindrical pipe which decreases in diameter. You can see this flow is steady, or laminar flow, because the motion of these particles is consistent and repeatable. Now, this is not how you will see fluid flow illustrated in textbooks because, well, textbooks are usually static objects and do not change over time like this animation. So, what is shown instead are called streamlines. Streamlines show the direction of the fluid flow. In other words, the velocity of a particle at each point in the path is tangent to the streamline. The fluid particles are moving in the direction indicated by the streamlines. In laminar flow, the streamlines will not change over time. And realize that the closer the streamlines are to one another, the faster the flow of the fluid.
Hold up.
Yes, Bo?
Why does the fluid flow faster when the pipe narrows in diameter?
That is a fair question. However, that is not for today. We will show that in a future lesson. Okay. All right. The last condition for ideal fluid flow is that ideal flow is irrotational. That means the fluid does not have net angular velocity. Yeah, the fluid does not rotate. One typical way that is illustrated is to say that if you were to place a small paddle wheel in the fluid, the paddle wheel would not rotate about its center of mass. The paddle wheel would maintain an angular velocity of zero. And those are the four conditions for ideal fluid flow. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.